Two summers ago, I decided to make a couple books before I went to college through jobs I'd applied to. So I applied to a movie theater, Brewster's, a ski and snowboard shop, and then what would become my full-time job that summer, a doggy daycare. I sat down in the interview and watched my boss forewarned me that getting scratched and clawed by small misbehaving dogs and dragged by big difficult dogs were to become the norm if I were to accept the position. But I accepted knowing I'd perform well. You know, I never had any dogs of my own, so I always had an interest in them. There we go. My first week working there, though, was a living hell. Before I could even approach a million meter radius of a dog, I was obligated to complete modules, which meant watching video after video, memorizing pamphlet after pamphlet, taking quiz after quiz about dog behavior, diseases, illnesses, parasites, worms of all sorts. My first day in action was July 3rd, the infamous predecessor to July 4th, and naturally the busiest day of the entire year. So coworkers who just introduced themselves to me left me with a handshake and a good luck, Teah, and like that, my training had commenced. I was in charge of booking and scheduling dogs, coordinating with veterinarians for medical records, vaccines, pitching offers to pet parents, managing the phones, emails, text messages, all while communicating with the whole team via walkie-talkie. The first dog I actually met was Murphy, some sort of mixed Australian shepherd, and it was when I met him that all of the training became worth it. I wanted to mess around with him and see what kind of tricks he knew, so I stuck out my hand for him to shake and he took it. And it was at the long gaze and paw shake that there was some sort of recognition or an empathy even between us. Inevitably, in a system as complex and layered as the front desk, I made a ton of mistakes. Misplacing collars, getting lost in the maze that was the boarding suites. I struggled to redress dogs with their unnecessarily oddly designed harnesses or various articles of dog clothing. Dogs who were regulars there were literally more familiar with the layout than I was, but with their inability to tell me, Teah, turn left here, they couldn't really have been of much help to me per se, but I could see myself growing to learn them better individually, their quirks and personalities. Two dogs I really grew fond of were a German Shepherd pair, Oliver and Madison, my personal favorite breed. Their pet parents, the team, and I always joked about their resemblance to Beauty and the Beast, with Madison being a bit more of the calm, graceful type, and Oliver being big, fluffy, and cumbersome with a loud presence. Now, Oliver was a big leash puller, so whenever the two were being picked up or dropped off, it always took two people to walk them individually into and out of the playrooms. So whenever the siblings were being picked up or dropped off and we'd hear Oliver and Madison for pickup over the walkie-talkie, somebody would invariably answer with a loud sign and I'm on my way. But I volunteered every time to take him off the hands of my coworkers, to which every time, without fail, they'd be surprised but relieved to hand him over. And they'd comment on my volunteering nature as a thanks, but I knew that I wasn't only taking him with selfless intent, it was more of an attempt to learn him or understand him. In between walks, I always made sure to practice getting him to sit, even though it takes him back and forth because of his stubborn nature. And over time, I could see us growing more familiar with each other. And with every walk, I learned a bit more about him, his tendencies, what triggers his anxieties, the particular spots on the ground he indulges in sniffing habitually. And I could also see him learning a bit more about me, where I'd rest at during break, and reciprocating communication, you know, looking to me for permission to go through a door instead of dragging me into it with no mercy. Every day I walked him, I grappled for a shared sense of understanding between us. And on the days that we didn't catch it flawlessly, we'd practice again and again until we did, in which case we always celebrated with treats and attempts to encourage it. I got a call from his pet parents. They voiced their concerns about his first grooming. They worried that he'd try and escape the tub or refuse it altogether, but I reassured him that they'd be in great hands, and I'd call them letting them know how the grooming went at the end of the day. To help him get comfortable in the bathroom, I took him on a lead walk around to help him gain his confidence. I let him sniff around, discover, and of course, kept his sister in the room with him the whole time for moral support. I was super excited with all of the progress we'd made all summer, and this bath was just the cherry on top of it all. The irony about working with dogs is that they're so intelligent and intuitive, sometimes to an extent that humans can't even compete with. Yet communicating with them in the way that we communicate with each other is impossible. Every single dog is different, and learning each individual pup's language takes time and effort. Observing them with other dogs, with other people on good days and bad days, takes time and effort, and with even more patience, we learn to do so with Oliver. It's in our nature to yearn for understanding in our environment, part of which we find through empathy with others, and doing so can be really complicated. Now, I'm about to take a bit of a turn here, but I want y'all to stick with me. Even the way people empathize differs vastly from person to person. So, for example, one way being by age. A study done by John DeSetti out of the University of Chicago found that when young kids observe pain in others, their periaqueductal gray, responsible for modulating pain, shows activity. Older kids show more activity in the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, responsible for emotional regulation. On the other hand, adults show more activity in areas such as the insula and amygdala, responsible for rendering emotions such as moral disgust. This trichotomy in brain activity shows that younger kids typically can't differentiate between intentional versus accidental harm, or even harm done to inanimate objects and people. Their ability to do so develops with age. Now, another example of ways people empathize differently is on a chemical level. Oxytocin and vasopressin are involved in prosociality, meaning anything ranging from parent-child bonds to generosity to trust and even empathy. Funny enough, oxytocin is also a crucial piece of empathy for a dog and its owner. As both secrete oxytocin, dogs tend to gaze at their owners for longer, gathering more information. People with genetic predisposals or more oxytocin or vasopressin tend to have more empathy. Ironically, though, a study done by Mark Dads out of the University of Sydney found that one very specific oxytocin gene receptor variant is linked to hostile behavior that foreshadows psychopathy. So in other words, the seemingly trivial or negligible variance in neurochemistry renders a world of difference in somebody's abilities and surrounding empathy. So even the most minute differences, like age or neurochemistry, make people experience and exude empathy wildly differently, on what we can go as far as calling a spectrum, even on a genetic level. You may be more accustomed to feeling suffering through music, while the person sitting next to you may prefer to do so through a Goya painting. You may prefer to express empathy through lengthy conversations, while the person sitting next to you may prefer to do so through humor and satire. It's this difference in complexity and people's abilities surrounding empathy, which is why it's necessary to foster empathy, whether it be with your friends, your family, or even your pets. And for me, fostering this empathy with dogs and growing to understand them despite the hurdles shows that, in short, to love is to be patient. Thank you.